So today we'll start the next topic, which is about high lift devices. If you try to just look and see what it tells you, high lift devices. So that means we are talking about any devices which would generate high lift. The moment we think about high lift, any sort of devices which would provide high lift, that means that device probably need to increase the area or the camber. So any of the device which by which we can increase the area or the camber, we can call them as the high lift devices. Now if I need to increase the area or the camber, how am I going to do so as per our convenience? So I can do so only if I have got a provision to control the thing. So either that could be in form of some additional surface which I can extend or retract depending on whether we want lift or not. If we want lift, we'll extend that surface and we'll get the additional surface or the additional camber, and thereby we'll be getting the additional lift. And if I decrease the area or decrease the camber, in that case I'm going to get a decreased net area and thereby reducing the net area and reducing the lift as well. So if I need to increase the lift, I need to increase either the camber or the area. And that's the entire concept of high lift devices. If I can do so as per the condition, as per my requirement, and if I can manipulate it, so that means I can do it as per my requirement. I can change it as per my requirement. In that case, that becomes your high lift devices. Now, because we need to add some additional surface, so that additional surface I can add either at the front or at the rear end of the wing. If I'm adding that additional surface at the front end of the wing, we call that as the leading edge device. And if we add that behind the wing, we will call that as trailing edge device. Now, this trailing edge device could be the trailing edge flap. It could be the different types of flap, plain flaps, slotted flap, Fowler flap, Zap flap, or it could be the flap attached to the leading edge, so we call that as the leading edge flap. Another name for it is Kruger flap, or it could be some form of slots, it could be some form of slats, so it could be anything. But the sole criteria is we are going to increase the camber or the area as per our convenience, as per the requirement. Okay, any doubt? So we'll try to look into flaprons. You have studied in your basic aerodynamics, and in the last class also I told about flapron. So flapron means we are combining the function of the flaps and aileron. Now because we are combining the function of the flap and aileron, so I can use it as flap or I can use it as aileron as per my convenience. If I'm going to use the flapron solely as flap, I can use it along with the main flap. As the aircraft we got here, Bjet 400A, it has got no separate aileron, it has got flapron. So we are not using aileron for rolling action, we are using the flapron for the rolling action. We'll be using the flapron, differential movement of the flapron will provide the rolling action. But if we want the flapron to be operated like a flap, in that case, I can operate both the flapron at the same time along with the normal flap, and in that case, it will provide the additional lift and drag that we require during takeoff and landing, and thereby we are using this as flap. So either we can use this as flap or either we can use it as aileron. It is entirely my purpose. How am I going to use it as per the requirement? And whether you're going to use it as flap or as aileron, that changing, that transition or the changeover depends on the mechanism called mixer unit. So it is the mixer unit through which I can change or do the transition. Okay? Any doubt? Okay. So another name for it is droop aileron. Next is the drag inducing devices. So any of the devices which are going to induce drag are the drag inducing devices, as the name suggests. So drag inducing devices implies that that surface need to be exposed to the airflow quite naturally. Yes or no? Any surface which if we can manage to get it exposed to the airflow will create the drag. Now that surface which we are going to expose to the airflow, it could be either at the wing, on top of the wing, below the wing, or it could be in any other part of the fuselage. It entirely depends on the designer where they want to put it. But the common area at the wing and at the tail cone area. Okay, so the old aircraft, the aircraft of 70s and 80s and 90s had these drag inducing devices on top of the wing or sometimes below the wing. But nowadays we are getting more of these aircraft where the drag inducing devices are at the tail cone. There is a reason for it, because the moment you operate in the drag inducing devices, so that drag inducing device will create the drag, isn't it, the air resistance, and there will be a turbulence. And if there is a turbulence, that means there will be vibration as well. And if that is part of the wing and the passenger sitting inside the fuselage can experience and can feel it, and it would lead to some degree of uncomfortable. So in order to remove that degree of uncomfortableness, because at the end of the day you are paying, isn't it? You are paying not to get uncomfortable but to fly comfortably. So definitely you won't want vibration. So the probable solution is keep it as far away as possible from the passenger. And the most obvious choice is the tail cone. Okay? So you have got different types of devices, drag inducing devices. We'll go into these devices one by one. So we'll start off with the spoiler. Again, regarding the spoiler, we have studied in the previous class as well, and you have studied in your basic aerodynamics as well. So what main difference you are going to study here that you have not studied in basic aerodynamics is, here we'll be looking into the fact that how do we actually operate the mechanism behind the spoiler. What are the connections involved, how we are going to operate it, what could be the different systems through which we are will be operating the spoiler. It could be by means of hydraulic forces, it could be by means of mechanical forces, it could be by means of pneumatic forces. So the forces could be anything. But this particular course note is based on Boeing 737. And that is why here in the description, whatever is given is mentioned in terms of the hydraulic forces. It is not essential and not necessary that the force will only be hydraulic, it could be anything. Okay, so because the syllabus deals with the hydraulic force, so we'll restrict our discussion up to hydraulic forces. Now, spoiler is part of the wing, and depending on whether you want to operate the spoiler as a roll inducing device or as a drag inducing device, it's again the choice is up to you. We are not considering now for the moment the roll inducing device, but we are looking spoiler in terms of drag inducing device. So the moment you operate the spoiler, you are allowing the spoiler to getting exposed to the airflow and thereby will generate more drag. Now, because we are able to generate drag, so there will be turbulent flow as well, and there will be vibration, and the passenger will feel uncomfortable. And the next possible solution is put it behind, as I mentioned. Now, if you want to operate the spoiler, because the spoiler being attached to the wing, so there must be some hinge point, isn't it? Correct? So there should be some hinge point. So there is some definitely some hinge point, as you can see in the diagram. So this is the hinge. Now, to operate the spoiler, we require some force. So what possibly will be that force? So as mentioned in your book, it is the hydraulic force. In certain type of aircraft, the spoiler is part of the autopilot system as well. So that means it should be able to operate on its own. We must have some criteria by which the spoiler must be able to operate on its own. Now the question is, how can we operate the spoiler on its own? First question. And the second question is, we might require the spoiler to be raised by 5 degree, by 6 degree, by 7 degree, so that the movement can be variable. So how can we make the movement to be variable? Okay? So we'll try to look into that. How I can make the spoiler to have variable degree of movement? The spoiler being connected to the hydraulic system. So if the spoiler movement need to be made variable, that means the hydraulic pressure which is moving the spoiler need to be variable as well, isn't it? So if my objective, I'm trying to figure out how we can do it. So if my objective is spoiler is to be made variable. No, the movement is to be made variable. How am I going to do it? Since it is operated by hydraulic pressure, so hydraulic pressure need to be variable, correct? So hydraulic pressure needs to be variable. Now, how am I going to make the hydraulic pressure variable? One of the possible reason or possible way could be the hydraulic pump. Make the RPM of the hydraulic pump variable, isn't it?
Yes.
So, RPM of hydraulic pump is made variable. Now, how can this be made variable, the hydraulic pump pressure? Because the pump pressure would depend on the RPM, and if the RPM is made variable, then the pump pressure becomes variable as well. So how can I change this RPM? I can change this RPM by changing the current value, isn't it? So by variable current, so current is made variable. How can I make the current to be made variable if the resistance is variable as well? Right? And if the whole thing, I want to make it as part of an automated system, the pilot is not controlling, the thing is doing its work on its own. No one is taking care of. We are assuming a situation that the whole thing can be done in an automated mode. So how this whole thing can be done in an automated mode? So that means the resistance variation. So we all need these things, and finally the bottom line is the resistance need to be made variable, and this should be in an automated mode. Right? So when do we require this variable movement of spoiler? Because certain time the aircraft flies at different altitude or at different speed, and we want different type of movement. So because the aircraft is flying at different altitude at different speed, so the basic criteria which determines all this thing is the pressure. So somehow if we can measure the pressure and use the pressure as a reference point based on which we are changing the spoiler. Okay, so what I'm going to do is use the pressure as a reference and get this pressure to manipulate this current value. So I'm changing this pressure now and using that to operate the spoiler. So because I'm using pressure and converting that into some form of current, so definitely I require a transducer. So I'm using this transducer. Now what transducer it is? It is a pressure transducer. What exactly we are doing? Since we are measuring the pressure, and we are not measuring the pressure directly, we are getting this reading from airspeed indicator,
vertical speed indicator and the altimeter. Airspeed indicator, it receives two pressure, static pressure and the total pressure, and it sends the difference between these two pressure and based on which we are able to get the forward speed of the aircraft. Because different speed, for different speed we require different spoiler movement. So with the different speed we are sensing the pressure, with the different pressure we are converting that into current, and by variable current we are getting different spoiler movement. Okay. Vertical speed indicator, the rate at which the aircraft is ascending, moving upward, and the rate at which the aircraft is descending, moving downward. Because the rate at which the aircraft would ascend or descend would also vary the pressure, isn't it? And based on that, we would require different degree of movement of the spoiler. Altimeter, the aircraft is flying at different altitudes. Different altitude implies different pressure as well. So we are again getting a variation in the pressure, and that variation again sensing the variation in current flow, and thereby we are having different degree of movement of the spoiler as well. Any doubts so far? Sure. Okay. What happened? So why this laptop has got problem, I don't understand. Quite. So, spoiler, we have seen the basic function, and the operation of spoiler is symmetric. Quite natural, you cannot have asymmetric deployment, isn't it? Because if there is asymmetric deployment, it will lead to rolling device. It will act like a rolling device. We require symmetric deployment of the spoiler if we want the spoiler to operate as a drag inducing device. And then if we need to make the whole system automatic, in that case I require all this instrument and everything need to be integrated. And that's why you can see here it is written, firstly they can be a primary roll control of the aircraft as described previously, and then the spoiler can be used in a symmetrical path deployment position. Path deployment means we are having a different degree of movement as per the speed, as per our requirement, allowing the aircraft to slow down quickly if you are using this as a drag inducing device in the cruise or during descent or during climbing without acceleration, and the deployment angle. So all these things are interrelated, and we need to, or the pilot need to take care of all these things before deploying the exact angle of the spoiler. Depending on the height, depending on the speed. So all these things need to be kept in mind before the pilot can move the spoiler to the desired angle. Now this is the normal speed brakes. Even though, as I told you, the spoilers are the normal speed brakes or the ground brakes, but the problem with the spoiler, as I mentioned previously, the moment you operate the spoiler there will be vibration and the passenger won't be comfortable. So why not to put it in some place away from the passenger, as much away from the passenger as possible. So the best alternative is put it in the tail cone. So if you are putting in the tail cone, as you can see in this diagram, this is the type of the spoiler. This is known as clamshell door type spoiler or speed brake. We don't call it spoiler, sorry. Speed brake, clamshell door type. So you can see here, the moment you are exposing these two, you are extending these two. So the air will come and hit these two surfaces and thereby will generate drag, isn't it? So this is how it functions. Now we look into wing vanes. If we just go by the term again, wing fence, I got some fence which I put over the wing. Now the question comes, what for I need to put some fence on top of the wing? Fence means I am restricting something, isn't it? So what I am restricting, if you just look at the diagram, you can see the way it is being put, that it is preventing some spanwise flow. What for you need to prevent this spanwise flow? Because this spanwise flow will somehow decrease the net value of the lift. Why is it so? Because the net value of lift depends on circulation. And circulation means circulation of the air. It is a actual definition of lift says it is the closed loop integral of the circulation. And circulation being a vector quantity, if the direction of the circulation changes, in that case, the net lift value would change as well. And if you try to look at the pressure distribution in the wing, on top of the wing and below the wing, on top of the wing at the root section, the pressure is negative and maximum negative. And as you move from the root to the tip portion, the pressure keeps on increasing, but still it is negative. Okay? And below the wing, at the root section, we have got the maximum positive pressure. As we move from root to the tip section, the pressure keeps on decreasing. So that would result in a circulation. Isn't it? It would result in a circulation. Now this direction of circulation is opposite to the circulation responsible for a proper lift. So somehow we need to get rid of the circulation. And the best possible way to get rid of the circulation is put some fence. So they put some fence here. So because it is being placed on the wing, so you call this as wing fence. Okay. So apart from that, what else it can do? It can straighten up the airflow. Make the airflow straight up. Why is it essential? Because if the airflow is straightened up, that implies that there will be less spillage of air. And because the more the spillage of air along the periphery of the wing, more will be the vortices in those areas. And those vortices will generate additional drag, and you don't want that. Okay? Any doubt? Next is sawtooth leading edge. In your workshop practices, you have seen the sawtooth. Now how it looks like, something like this, isn't it? So if you look in this diagram and if you relate to this one, you can see there is a similarity, isn't it? So what for the sharp points are required? The moment I give some sharp points, some sharp curvature, and if the air comes and strike the surface, the sharp curvature, there will be turbulence, isn't it? So this is mainly used to generate turbulence. Now the question is, what for I need the turbulence? The reason I need the turbulence is, turbulence can prevent stalling. Now the question comes in, how turbulence can prevent stalling? So if an aircraft gets stalled, the most simple way to understand stalling is if the air which is moving over the top of the aerofoil over the wing stops because of the adverse pressure gradient behind and then reverses its direction. And if somehow we can manage to prevent the air from stopping and let it flow normally, we can prevent the stall. So what is making the air stop? That means the air has got no energy in it, isn't it? So if we can pump in some energy into it, the air won't stop and it will flow smoothly and there won't be any stalling. Yes or no? And that's the sole reason why we are using this type of notches. Because the moment I put the notch, there will be some turbulence. And this turbulent air will energize this dead air and thereby increasing its velocity and thereby preventing stalling. Okay? If you look into each of this type of devices which are mainly used to prevent stalling, you will find that their location is somewhere in the root section. Because it is the root section which is more vulnerable of stalling. Why is it so? Assume a normal aircraft, and assume my hand to be the wing, with the finger to be the tip of the wing and this to be the root section of the wing. And assume the aircraft is making a turn. If the aircraft is making a turn, the tip of the wing needs to travel a greater radius compared to the root portion, isn't it? So this is traveling at lesser radius and this is traveling at a greater radius. So quite natural, this will have higher velocity compared to this portion. Right? So this is having higher velocity and this portion is having lower velocity. Now try to recall the definition for the stalling. The definition for stalling says it is the maximum angle at which the aircraft can fly straight and level, or in terms of speed, it is the minimum speed at which the aircraft can fly straight and level. Right? So either it is the maximum angle or the minimum speed. Now consider the fact that the aircraft is turning, so this portion is having lower speed. So this portion is more vulnerable to stalling. So if I need to prevent stalling here, I need to induce turbulent flow. I need to induce turbulent flow implies I need to have this sort of a structure. And that is where we will find all the structure are at the root section and not at the tip. The tip are not vulnerable to stall. It is the root section which is most vulnerable to stalling. Any doubt? Yes. Okay. Next is winglets. Now you are familiar with the structure of the winglets and you have studied in your basic aerodynamics that the purpose of this winglet, and if you just go by the diagram as well, it is preventing the air from moving below the wing to the top of the wing, right? Or rather, it is preventing some vortices. Now, as it is preventing the air from the downstream air, as it is preventing, this is the aerofoil, air coming in, this is the downstream air. So it is preventing the downstream air from moving upward, isn't it? I've got the winglet here. It is preventing this downstream air from moving upward and thereby preventing the vortices. Now, if it is preventing this air from moving upward, in other words, I can say it is assisting the air to move downward. It is like, let's say if I need to say XY is bad, I can also say XY is not good, isn't it? Both are same thing. So this is preventing the air from moving upward. In other words, I can say this is assisting the air to travel rearward, below, isn't it? So if somehow indirectly it is helping the air to move below. Now this one, I can always resolve into two components, the horizontal component and the vertical component, isn't it? Correct?
Yes.
So this horizontal component, if this is the action, I have got this reaction here. Now this reaction is providing the additional thrust. Yes or no?
Yes.
So we are getting an increased thrust. Okay? Any doubt? Okay? What doubt? What doubt? What I'm trying to say is, it is preventing the air from moving upward. So indirectly we can say it is allowing the air to travel downward. So this is how the air is traveling. Okay? Now this I can resolve into two components. Naturally, the horizontal component and the vertical component. Okay? If this is the action force, as per Newton's third law, there will be a reaction force. So I've got a reaction force in this direction, which is along the thrust line.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
So we are getting an increased thrust. Now because it is preventing the spillage of air, so in other words, we can say it is also preventing the drag, right? So it is preventing the drag associated with it. But at the same time, this portion, the winglet, in itself, when it is, as it is exposed to the airflow, is creating drag. But then this drag is different from this drag. How? This drag is because of the winglet, and the winglet, its sole purpose is to provide the drag. It is not a lift inducing device. Because it is not a lift inducing device, so the drag developed or generated because of it is a parasite drag. Right? Any doubt? Yes or no?
No doubt, sir.
Okay, so this is parasitic drag. And this drag, because I got a thrust here, so quite natural I got a drag here as well. And this drag is a result of lift. So this one is an induced drag. So I'm getting parasitic drag and I'm getting induced drag. Okay? Now if you try to recall the graph or the curve for the velocity and drag curve for both the for the two drag, the parasitic drag and the induced drag, and if you try to recall the formula for the induced drag and the parasitic drag, if you recall that a normal parasitic drag is proportional to the square of velocity and the induced drag is inversely proportional to the square of velocity, right? Do you remember that?
Yes.
If you do not remember, go back and study your basic aerodynamics. And whoever remember, try to recall one particular page of your book where the graph is given. The graph looks like, if I combine both this, it looks like, now if I draw the velocity and the drag curve, for one case, the drag is proportional to the square of velocity, so it will be something like this. And for the other one, it is inversely proportional, decreasing. And the net value of the drag will be this minus whatever this value is. So this is the net value of drag at this point, this is the net value of drag at this point, net value of drag at this point. So this way we can find the net value of the drag. And if we try to calculate the net value of the graph at each point, you will find that its value actually decreases. So this has got more useful effect than harmful effect. This is creating, if I combine this drag and this drag, it is generating less drag. So this is more useful than harmful. So winglet is used in executive jets and these business class jets. So its sole purpose is to prevent the air from moving upward. In other words, we can say it is assisting the air to travel rearward, and by doing so, it is generating or giving us an increased value of thrust and a net reduction in drag. Okay, now if the net value of the drag is decreased, so what we are getting is, if I look at the curve, net value of drag is decreased. So net value of drag is decreased. Now if you recall from your basic aerodynamics, in a cruise flight condition, drag and thrust are equivalent. So if the net value of drag is decreased, so this implies that the thrust value would decrease as well. And if the thrust value is decreasing, that means the engine is doing less work. Engine RPM is low. And if the engine RPM is low, that means less fuel is getting burned. Or in other words, we are increasing the fuel consumption. Sorry, decreasing the fuel consumption. So by having this particular configuration, apart from net decrease in drag, gaining an increase in the thrust, we are able to achieve a net reduction in the fuel consumption. Any doubt? Okay. We'll look into the boundary layer control next. So boundary layer control, we are controlling the boundary layer. Now the question comes in, what for I need to control the boundary layer? So let's recall the definition of the boundary layer. So you have got an aerofoil with the air moving over the aerofoil. Now this air, which is along the surface of the aerofoil, has got zero velocity, isn't it? As we keep moving upward, the velocity keeps on increasing till the time the velocity becomes equivalent to the free stream velocity, and this net length is identified by the letter delta, which is the boundary length, boundary layer length, isn't it? Boundary layer thickness. You remember that? And now we try to look the thing in a bit different way. Not exactly correct, but another way to look at the thing in a bit simpler way. The way I am trying to define it is not technically very correct, but somewhat easy to understand. So these are the laminar layer. Okay? Now if I am trying to look into the turbulent, so this one, this particular layer, if getting converted into a turbulent, that means getting the shape of an eddies, isn't it? Correct? In a circular form, eddies, bit circular. So this straight line, I can replace with a circle. The another line on top of it, I can also replace with a circle. The another line on top of it, I can also replace with a circle. Okay, so I have got these three here and these three here. Quite natural, this length is more, or this thickness is more than this one, isn't it? Yes or no?
Yes.
So boundary layer thickness in case of a turbulent flow is more compared to the laminar flow. First point. Second point is, now these are circles. Okay, circular flow. Now the question comes in, why these are having so high energy? Again, the proper reasoning is difficult. I'll try to make it simple. And a simple way of looking into the thing is, assume a water drop. So the water drop is of this shape. All of you are aware of, isn't it? Right? Any doubt? Now this shape we are getting, here we have got this sharp point. This sharp point we are getting because of the surface tension. So if I remove the surface tension, I assume there is no surface tension, it will be perfectly spherical. Why the shape is spherical? Because this particular shape, the sphere, is having probably, topologically, the least possible energy. And everyone tries to remain in a state of lowest energy. I won't prefer to stand. I am forced to stand and talk to you because I am being paid for it. If I am not being paid for it, I would rather prefer to sit. And in my home, rather, I would prefer to sleep rather than sitting on a chair, isn't it? It's no different from you as well. So everyone tries to remain in a state of lowest energy. With no exception, the water droplet also tries to remain in a state of lowest energy. And that's why this shape is spherical. Now this I'm looking in terms of three dimension. In terms of two dimension, this sphere is some sort of a circle. So here also these are circles, so we can somehow get a bit of similarity that these probably are having some very low energy. But these are not isolated. I have got air everywhere. And this air are having higher energy. Correct. So they will supply energy to this. And this energy will increase. By what I mean by energy increases, if the energy getting increased, because these are air molecules, nitrogen, oxygen and all this stuff. So they will be colliding and vibrating more. More they collide, more will be their speed, isn't it? So the net value of the speed will increase, so they will have finally higher speed. So in boundary layer control, I have got certain portion laminar. The flow will always start off as a laminar flow and then will get converted into a turbulent flow, and this is based on Reynolds number. We have discussed in the last class, isn't it? Reynolds equation? Yes or no? And so why that makes sense is because of the Reynolds number. We need to look and manipulate the Reynolds number, and that's how we can figure out why that makes sense. So initially the flow will be laminar and then will get converted into a turbulent flow. And if I need to manipulate this flow, I don't want, let's say a condition comes in where I need laminar flow up to this and the remaining region I need turbulent flow. And the point from where the flow starts transiting from laminar to turbulent, we call that as the transition point. Now let's say, in the next moment, I require laminar up to here and turbulent up to here. Or maybe I require laminar up to here and turbulent from here to here. I might require, because I would require different type of flow depending on the speed, stalling characteristics, depending on the flight performance. So I need to vary this airflow. If I'm going to vary the airflow, that means what exactly we are varying? We are varying this transition point, isn't it? The moment the speed is getting increased, so if the velocity is getting increased, we know with increasing velocity, that means the flow is more turbulent. Yes or no? Yes or no?
Yes.
So more velocity means more turbulent, and more turbulent means now this is going forward. Going forward means the transition point is shifting forward. So with increase in velocity, the transition point will move from rear to the forward portion. Okay. I thought of doing video for this. I put the video. Whatever I'm talking now, I put the video. So I can put another aviation type video in the YouTube. I guess we can take 2-3 minutes break if you want. So the next week you will be coming, correct? Or you will be many of you won't be coming because of Hari Raya?
Friday.
Next week?
Friday.
Friday you won't be coming?
Yeah.
Why? But all of you are Chinese, mostly Chinese. Chinese won't celebrate Hari Raya. Anyway, in the next class, we'll be doing the practical. The first one or two practicals we'll be doing. Okay? Hey, don't use phone. Hey! What happened to your t-shirt? Forgot. Why? Okay, so let's start again. Everybody in? Okay, so the next topic is vortex generators. So as the name suggests, generator is generating something. So what exactly it is generating? Vortex, vortices. What would you need to generate vortices? Turbulent flow, isn't it? What for you want turbulent flow? To prevent stalling. So this vortex generator, it could be at the top. This is a permanent part of the wing, as you can see here. And as you can see in the diagram, it is generating the vortices. By generating the vortices, it is increasing the velocity of the air, and this increased velocity of the air is, this air is being pumped to the dead air and preventing this aircraft from getting stalled. And because stalling is most likely to occur at the root section compared to the tip section, so we will find majority of these vortex generator are near to this root section. Okay, so whatever I told you, the same thing is written in your book. Stall wages. Again, if you look at the diagram, if you look at the picture, this is how the stall wages look like. And you can see again here, the stall wages is at the root section and not at the tip area. Isn't it? It's in the inboard side. So the sharp edge at the inboard side at the root section implies that whenever the air comes and hit this surface, it will get converted to a turbulent flow, right? Because got sharp edges, the air can flow smoothly, so the flow will be turbulent. And if the flow gets turbulent, that means again it is used to prevent what? Stalling. Stalling is most likely to occur at the root section. So I have got this at the Okay. These are the leading edge device, another boundary layer control devices, the leading edge flap. Another name for one name for it is the Kruger flap. Another name for it is gooseneck flap. If you look at the structure, it looks like the shape looks like the neck of a goose, so you call that as, some books call that as gooseneck flap. And as you can see here, you can either extend it or retract it, and extension and retraction is by means of the actuator, and the actuator means definitely some hydraulic pressure, isn't it? You cannot always let it remain exposed, because every time if it is exposed, it will create additional drag. And we don't want additional drag, so we use it only when it is required, and the remaining time we'll get it in the retracted position. So we'll only extend it whenever it is required, and whenever we do not require it, retract it. So this retraction and extension is by means of the actuator, and or in other words, we can say it is by means of the hydraulic pressure. Okay. It can be droop snoop or permanent droop type, or it can be adjusted during flight. Permanently like this, or you can adjust during flight. As per your, you know, it all depends on the design. What type of leading edge devices are you using? So we are done up to this. From the next topic onwards, we'll do in the next class. Okay. So, do you have any doubt?
No, sir.
Sure.
Sure.